Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
Come on, stand to your feet and let's go before the Lord. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor. Thank you, Lord, that the fruit of your Spirit, that which your Spirit produces, is love. Second one is joy. And we just thank you, Father, the joy of the Lord that's in this house tonight. We give you the praise, glory, and honor. We thank you, Father, that we haven't come to hear from a man. Oh, thank God. We have come to hear from the teacher of the church, who is the Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us, and motivate us to be all that you would have us to be. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and all the honor as you bless us tonight. We would ask that you bless all the churches in the Inland Empire, as well as around the planet, that are preaching and hearing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. If they're preaching and hearing the gospel, they're our brothers and our sisters. We ask you to bless them. Bless our Baptist brothers, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalian, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapels and Harvest, Oak Valley and Oasis, the Well, the Way, the Ecclesia Church. Thank you, God, for all the great things that are happening, Trinity, all the great churches that are out there. In no time, Lord, do we see ourselves as better than them. We just see ourselves as co-laborers, workers in the field, building the kingdom of God. Our Catholic brothers and sisters, our Adventist brothers and sisters, bless them as well, Father, and we'll give you the praise, give you all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name, with a great big shout, we say amen. Amen. I have absolutely no idea where I'm going, so just open your Bible and just start reading. I just want to play with you tonight. Oh, I have this note. For those of you that are new, this is about freedom for our future. We had just a fabulous, if you weren't here, we had a fabulous weekend. And nobody gave any money, but we had a fabulous weekend. It was just so much fun. Those of you that did give, three of you, want to thank you very much. But we don't care. It's about the heart, and all of us grew a lot about that. It was great. Freedom for Our Future is a great campaign. And then Sunday night we had a party. You know? And so we had a DJ, and everybody's out there. They're dancing. Of course, dancing for a lot of people in church, like the big taboo, you know? In fact, Joel's wife, Joanne, Pastor Joanne, first time she ever danced in her life was at this church. They're both pastors' kids. Their parents, that means their parents were pastors. And they grew up in houses where they didn't dance. And they came to this place. They said, "You sure it's okay to dance?" I said, "Yeah." She went nuts, man. She was dancing all over the place. She hadn't stopped dancing. But anyway, our church's so funny. When we play the Beach Boys, nobody danced. And as soon as it had a little Latin sound to it, everybody was out there just going. I mean, it was like the place was packed with Latin dancers, you know what I mean? So, guys, we learned our lesson. Forget it. It's great. Forget hot dogs. Let's make it tacos. Everybody bought tacos, nobody bought hot dogs. So it's really fascinating. Our church, I've got this note. You know, there's a widow's mite, and this had nothing to do with my message. I don't even know if I'm going to get in the message. Maybe. The widow's mite. You remember that we talked about the widow's mite, how Jesus sees this lady. She puts in practically nothing. And he turns to his disciples and he says to his disciples, "This woman gave more than all the rest." And, you know, these other guys are just dumping in big cash and big money and all that kind of stuff. And they're kind of like baffled. Like, this woman just gave nothing. But made it so important that God wrote about it in the scripture, and it's been pinned in scripture and been preserved for thousands of years so you and I can understand about the heart, is that the neat thing is that the widow's mite was given from her heart, and it was all that she had. Wasn't a lot in comparison to other people, but it was more than everybody else because it came from her heart, and it came because it was all she had. And it's called the widow's mite, and it's a fascinating presentation by Jesus about how important the heart is behind giving. Receive this note. This little note. I have a copy of it the office gave me this morning on my desk. And it's written by, he describes himself, I'm just a kid. About every third or fourth word is misspelled. Handwriting in pencil. And I'll read it to you. And to me, this is the most valuable moment of the whole weekend for me. If you get my picture, I don't know what that means. I want you, and all of this spelled incorrectly, so cute. I want you to know that I will give everything I can. I am just a kid, but I am able to do a lot. I can make enough money. My goal is $200. I will make this a promise. Totally spelled. I had to figure out that word promise. It's just so cute. I make this a promise. Just have faith that it is what I have learned never to give up and have heard Pastor Jim, Pastor Dan, and I believe in you sincerely. And he's signed his name. I mean, is that the coolest little thing? That, I mean, so widow's mite, that's worth it all. Somebody will grow up be a mighty man of God because he'll remember this experience with the things of the Lord. If I can, let me just share this with you, and then I'm going to get right into quickly the Word of God, how to stay healthy with God. One of the neat things about this church, you put the title up because I just said that, how to stay healthy with God, thanks. One of the neat things about this church is that it's a very healthy church. Healthy in terms of honesty and integrity and holiness. Healthy in terms of saying it like it is, being up front, being righteous before the Lord. None of us are perfect in here, including me and Deborah. But it is a healthy church. It's not a church that is deceiving or deceitful in any way, but it's a church that's sincerely doing all that it can and has for many years to do the best that God would have us to do with what we have. If we had more, we would do more. But somehow, if God wanted us to have more, we'd have more and we'd be doing more. So it's really not the issue of getting more. It's really the issue of getting more God. And I believe it to be a healthy church. And what makes a healthy church is a healthy congregation, healthy people. And that's you. It would be a sad indictment of all of us that are in the pastoral ministry if we just did not have you in mind as we do what we do. We do what we do in women's ministry. We do what we do in men's ministry. We do what we do every single week. 11 services a week. That's like crazy, first of all. We say that to people. People say, what? 11 services. Other pastors can't even believe that we'd have 11 services a week. It's just unheard of because every service is a lot of work. I mean, we do everything we can to take care of you. When you walked in, you saw the roof all torn off because during the construction stage, there was somebody who part of that roof fell on them and almost killed them during construction. We noticed it was cracking a lot, so here's another expense. We've got to take the next couple of weeks and tear the inner foyer apart, and forgive us for that. We'll clean it up before every church service, do the best we can so none of you do anything. But we want to make sure your kids aren't hurt, you're not hurt, and do it the right way. And so we're going to be putting up the right kind of things. We just have you in mind. And so when I come along and I make a statement how to stay healthy with God, it's a really important statement. And here's why. There's since we've been tracking salvations, which has been probably the last 15 or 16 years. Since we've been tracking, we're 26 years old, probably didn't even start counting salvations for the first 10 years. But since we've been tracking salvations, it's been like 250,000 people that have walked down the aisles. Maybe tonight there's maybe a couple thousand adults here, plus kids, plus youth. And, you know, so there might be 2,500, 3,000 people at church. Where are the other 247,000 people that came to church and got saved? It's really a good question. And will somebody be asking that about you a few years from now? That you used to be someone who went to church and had a great relationship with God, and somewhere along the line you stagnated and stopped going to church and stopped getting involved and stopped making the effort and found yourself just like those other 247,000. Not all of them went away from church. They went to other churches. They maybe weren't in the area. A lot of people, you can probably count at least half of them that go to other churches and things like that, and that's fine. But there's tens of thousands of people that should be here tonight that are not here. And until you and I understand that the condition of being healthy is your own personal responsibility, then nothing is going to help you. I can't help you. No pastor in this church can help you. No man or woman of God anywhere can wave a magic wand over your head and help you. You're going to have to take the responsibility that what I am this year, I will not be next year. I'll be greater with God, not less with God. I'm not going to stay the same. I'm not going to be in that trap. I'm not going to fall away. I'm not going to be excited for God this year and bored next year. I'm going to stir myself up on a constant basis, like Paul writes to Timothy. I'm going to stir myself up. I'm not letting myself get down. I'm going to go with God. And that's like this church is healthy because it keeps on keeping on. And you're healthy with God when you keep on keeping on and you stand strong and stay strong and you get strengthened all the time every week as you come and get into a place with God. And that's what this is really all about. In Psalms 92, verse number 12, let me pop it up on the overhead, it says, the righteous shall flourish like a palm tree. He shall grow like the cedars of Lebanon. Now, wait a minute. Didn't say the righteous shall say the same. Didn't say those that are washed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, is bored out of their mind, don't give a flip about God or God's ways, don't care about going to church, don't care about being the man or woman of God that they've been called and the price has been paid for them to be. What it says is they shall flourish like a palm tree that grows very fast and sturdy like the cedars of Lebanon. And that is what a healthy person ought to be like. They get saved and they grow and they never stop growing. In other words, I'm the different Christian that I was when I first started because I've never stopped growing. There's always more of God than I can even imagine. I know very little about God compared to how much there is about God. And you're fooling yourself if you think you know it all. And some people come along and they say, well, you just don't teach me. Can I tell you something? It's not about me. It's about you taking the responsibility of finding yourself into a place with God where you grow. It doesn't say that the righteous shall flourish like a palm tree if they happen to listen to Pastor Jim. I don't see that in the Bible. They flourish because, man, they're connected with God. They're staying in their righteousness. They're getting strong and they're moving forward. The church's job is twofold. One, get people saved. Second, get them to maturity. And maturity comes a little bit at a time. And so the job that we have is to see that you remain healthy and that someday someone doesn't stand in this pulpit and say, well, there's been 500,000 salvations and we're still at 2,000 on a Wednesday night. Because you fell away and a brand new group of people are here. How sad is that? And how sad would it be before God when you stand before God if you let that happen to yourself? You have got to take the responsibility that there is something. You've got to stir yourself up every single day. Yes, there's pressures. Yes, there's trials. Yes, there's problems. But you got to stir yourself up and not let yourself get complacent with the things of God. You don't know nothing about God, and neither do I. There's more that God wants to share with us. And we forget that all the time, and we get to the place where we're lazy-minded, lazy, and then all of a sudden, instead of being healthy, we're unhealthy Christians, and it won't be long before you walk away from the things of God. And that would be a real tragedy. Four things will help us stay healthy with God. God gave me four quick things. I'm just going to pop them up on the overhead. Y'all just make a little note of this if you can. Number one, keep your mind fixed on Him. Have you ever thought about what you think about during the day? No, of course not. Nobody stops and says, well, I'm thinking about my car all day. I'm thinking about my job all day. I'm thinking about my work all day. Have you ever stopped and really thought about how much time during the day you literally meditate on who He is and what He has for you? Compared to the day, 24 hours a day, all day long, have you ever stopped and tried to take an analysis of your lifestyle and how much that you think about God? Because listen to this. The Bible says, as a man thinks in his heart, can you finish the verse? So is he. So if I'm thinking about other stuff, my school, my boss, my job, my finances, my economics, what people think of me, my job, my home, my car, my freeway, my travel, my experience, I get all worn out all day long by the world that wants to come in and rob from me when I should be finding myself spending time in meditation of who He is and what He wants me to do and live by. In order to stay healthy, you're going to have to stay connected. Let me say it again. Whether you like it or not, in order to stay healthy, you're going to have to stay connected because you are made to be connected. Each one of us have something to give, and we need each other. And by yourself, history tells us you will fall to the ways of the world. Did you know that? History tells us for thousands of years that the world will come in and suck you right down the toilet with all of them. Well, you live, if you're born of the Spirit of God, you understand what I'm saying. You are born again. You are alive forevermore. And you live in a world that is already dead until they get saved. You live among dead people that are walking around in the shopping centers, on their cars, dropping and driving, working on the job. You live among dead people, and you're alive. And what in the world? If you don't find yourself connected on a regular basis throughout the entire day with Him, you will find yourself soon disconnected. Is anybody listening? In fact, the wonderful Word of God, let me just share some verses with you. Paul writes to Timothy, and he tells Timothy about all the things he should be doing, showing off the Word, showing his life, living a certain kind of life. Tells him what to do. And then he makes this statement, 1 Timothy 4, chapter verse 15. Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them. These are the things of God. Now, wait a minute. Would God tell us to give ourselves entirely to the things of God if we could not do it? The difference is between healthy and unhealthy, between connected and disconnected. And that's the difference, is what you think all day long is what you will become. If you think of yourself as a loser, if you think of yourself as a failure, if you see yourself as down and out, if you see yourself as part of the world, if you see yourself as that, you will find yourself failing in life. And he tells him, he says, give yourself entirely to them. What for? That the progress may be evident to all. My goodness sake, all of us are in a progress. And it's just a progress of health, progress of life. In 1 John, the second chapter, write it down, verse 15 through 17. These three verses are so powerful. It said, do not love the world or the things that are in the world. It's so easy for us to have our minds so fixed on the things of the world that we don't think very much during the day about who God is and what God wants to do and what God promised us and what God spoke to us. You know, a lot of words were spoken by the Holy Spirit to a bunch of people. There were hundreds of you up here in front. And those words by most of you will be forgotten by God by tomorrow. And that should not be that way. And it says, do not love the world or the things that are in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. So there's no way I can love the Father and love the world. And yet the world wants to come in on a regular basis and bombard my thinking, a regular basis and destroy my marriage, regular basis and destroy my work, a regular basis and get me caught back up in ways that will destroy me and keep me from being healthy with God. And I become this unhealthy Christian, complaining, fooling around, messing around, never going on with God, all because I stopped what I was thinking. Verse 16 says it like this. It says, for all that is in this world, the lust of the flesh, here's what's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life is not of the Father, but of the world. In other words, if you're thinking of stuff that keeps you away from God and disconnects you with God, it won't be long before the pride of life comes in. It won't be long before lust of the flesh or lust of the eye comes in. And all of a sudden, you're starting to be controlled. You have to every day bring yourself back to the meditations of what God is, what God's done for you, who you are in Christ Jesus, and what God wants to do for you in order to stay connected, in order to stay healthy with things of God, because it starts with your thinking process. Is anybody listening? We're talking about simple four things that'll help you stay healthy with God. Number one, keep your mind fixed on Him. Number two, work at walking in God's ways. And I say it like this, work at it. Because there's times when you won't always walk in God's ways. Come on. If you think you're going to always walk in God's ways, then you're nuts. And we'll, after church, there'll be a prayer teams up here that'll cast the nut devil out of you. Because, is there a nut devil? Must be. I've seen a lot of them nowadays, especially third service. You didn't get that, did you? work at walking in God's ways. You got to work at this. In other words, sometimes I just don't feel like responding God's ways. I feel like cussing. Am I the only honest person in this building? You know what I'm talking about. I feel like anger. I feel like strife. I feel like anxiety. I feel like frustration. I feel like a whole lot of stuff, but my feelings can't control what I'm supposed to be doing, so I gotta work at not doing my feelings and doing what God says. In the book of Ephesians, it says, walk worthy of your calling. In other words, get out there and do what God called you to do. You're no longer what you used to be. Don't walk that way. Walk, and don't walk the way the world walks as an unhealthy person. Walk the way God would have you to walk. You say, why are you doing all the hand thing? I don't know. But walk worthy of God's ways. I like the word of God because it says in Proverbs, the 4th chapter, verse 18, for the path of the just is like the shining sun that shines ever brighter into the perfect day. Here's what I'm saying. If you're walking God's way, somehow your path is just going to get better and better and better. You may start off with a real terrible day. Anybody ever had a bad day? A sucky day. Can I use that word in the pulpit? No, Debbie says no. Okay, Luke, Pastor Luke says yes. Two generations right there. One said no, the other one said yes, they did. I'm a total mess. I don't know who to listen to over there. But anyway, it should start off with a bad day. And instead of having a bad day, man, listen to this. But the path of the just is like the shining sun that shines ever brighter into a perfect day. In other words, I can start off with a bad day, but if I stay the ways of God, it's going to turn out to be a... Wait a minute. You missed it. I can start off with a bad day, but if I stay the path with God, by the end of the day, it will be a... And how many want a bad day instead of a perfect day? Raise your hand if you want a bad day instead of a perfect day. Because we went in and prayed for you after church, cast every devil out of you, got a whole legion of them in you. Anybody? So that makes it very clear that your path is very important. And so we need to work at walking in his ways. Sometimes you don't. Then you repent and you get back to God. And you repent and you say, God, I'm sorry. I was walking in faith yesterday. Today, I'm not walking in faith. I was walking believing God for you the other day. I was just totally up, man. And now I'm just down. I don't understand this. Then shake yourself, repent, and get back to God. Because guess what? As you walk God's ways, the day becomes perfect. It's true. I didn't write that. If I wrote it, I would collect the royalties on the Bible. And I'd be very rich. And I'd take you all to Maui. How many want to go to Maui? Don't raise your hand. We're not going there again. I like this. Very important for all of us to understand. Number three, four things that will keep you to stay healthy with God. You got to spend time with God. You got to spend time with God. That's why, you know, can I just say something about this? Whether you like it or don't like it, some of you have come to church once every 2 or 3 weeks, and that's more than you've ever done in your life. Your whole family says you're crazy and radical, and why do you go to church on some other day other than Sunday? And you know, what's that all about? You're not getting goofy. Why don't you hold your religion to yourself? All that kind of stuff. I've heard it all of my life. And can I just say something to you? The more you're in a place where you're getting fed the Word of God, the stronger you're going to be. And it's very important that you spend time with God, not only in church, but prayer time or walking time or singing time, shower time, bathroom time, reading time. In other words, you do a lot of stuff throughout the day, but how much time do you spend with God? Can you spend a little bit more? Because the more time you spend with God, doesn't matter what you're doing. You don't have to get into the great intercession. That's hard for some people, especially us men. You don't have to get into great evaluation of reading your Bible. Sometimes that's not it. Maybe just singing a song. Maybe just telling him how grateful you are. Maybe just telling him how much you love him, how much you appreciate the fact that you're different. Just spending time with God. Did you know the more time you spend with someone, the more you get to know them? And the more you get to know that person, and when it's God, the more you fall in love with him. And the more you fall in love with them, the healthier you become. Imagine that. I heard someone say one time, he said, God just wants to fellowship with you. You know, the truth is God just wants to fellowship with you. Can I just say it like this? He does not need to fellowship with you or me. He's God. Doesn't need anything. We need to fellowship with him. We need to be with him. We need to have a healthy relationship with him. And it all comes by spending time. I can't tell you how many times over the years we've counseled with people that are getting divorces because the husband is gone. When the husband's out of sight, out of mind, or the wife is gone, out of sight, out of mind, it's a very difficult pressure on a marriage. It takes a very strong spiritual marriage to continue in the relationship. And the more time you spend together, the greater your marriage is going to be. And it's the same thing with God. Spend a little time with God. The verse is so cool. It's Psalms 84, verse number 7 says this. They will go from strength to strength. Each one appears before God in Zion. In other words, somebody's got to go before God and they'll go from strength to strength. Spending time with God is wonderful. You can do it in your practice, doctor. You could do it in your business, Federico. You can do it in Joe as you work for the county. You can do it in every area of your life. You could do it as you paint houses. You could do it as you are the plumbers that God's called you to be. You could do it wherever you're at, because it only takes a moment to turn your heart on to God. And at that very moment, the other day I was sitting in Debbie had a doctor's appointment for eye, and I was sitting in the doctor's office. It took a long time. She kept texting me. And I wanted to text her back and say, stop texting me. Get this over with. Let's go home. You know, but the doctor was caught up with somebody else and didn't get into her for quite a while. And I just spent time in the lobby with God, And you know what? When I got out of that place, I was happy. I was filled. Notice what it says, strength to strength. You get stronger when you spend some time with God. Last one for tonight. Four things that will help you stay healthy with God is fight to hold on to righteousness. Look, you are not just common people. Stop acting like common people. Remember from number two, walk worthy of your calling. Walk in his ways. And sometimes we act just like the world, when in fact we are really different than the world. And as I said to you before, the world is filled with dead people that are dead already until they get their life regenerated by Jesus Christ. They're dead. And you and I don't need to act like them. We're full of life. We're born of the Spirit of God. We're brought back into a new family. Who are we? We're not common people. We've got God Almighty, the creator of the heavens and the earth. He backs us in everything that we do. Whatever we say, wherever we go, whatever we do, God is with us. He's our protector. He's our provider. He's our healer. He's our justifier. He's our sanctifier. He's God Almighty. My goodness, we're alone? No. We're healed by his stripes. We're adopted into his family. We're heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Why do we act like mere men? When you get saved, you're a new creation in Christ Jesus. And why in the world would you want to stay the same, act the same, do the same? The Bible makes it very clear. You're going to have to fight to hold on to righteousness, because the world wants to come in and make you common again. And the devil wants to defeat you at every turn of the road, but he can't do it unless you give him permission to do it. We're different, because we're washed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're not arrogant, nor are we pompous, nor are we conceited, nor are we proud. But we are people who know who we are in Christ Jesus, and no weapon formed against us shall prosper. And greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. And I got to fight to hold on to righteousness. One of the building projects I'm on, I want to tell you this story, is that having a hard time, Southern California Edison. Edison is never, and I don't care if anybody works for Edison here, I'm going to tell you what I think. Nothing but problems. Arrogant, pompous, horrible service. What used to be free has cost me $55,000, and nobody told me that it was going to cost me $55,000. That's ridiculous. Deborah's drawn, designed, and built one of the most beautiful homes in all of Redlands, overlooking everything in the whole valley, sitting on a hill. And a year and a quarter ago, they came, their executives, and said, yes, put the power meter, there's a power box that goes on the outside of the house, back in this corner, it's fine, come up this part of the driveway, we'll come up to here and then up the back part of the lot. It'll be perfect back there. And we said, okay, we'll do that. Because we're in a framing part of this thing. We got instructions from them. Month goes by, 2 months, nobody says a word to us. About 3 months goes by. Another guy comes out and looks at it and says, oh, that's not where you're to put it. Now, wait a minute. We've already put it there. Because the last guy, so-and-so, told, oh, he's no longer, he's been transferred. I'm the boss now. And you can't take it from here. You got to put it on the other side of the house. Wait a minute. It's already framed. It's already in place. The trenches are already dug. It's already stuccoed, completed. And now I'm going to have to tear it all out and do it on the other side of the house. Yes. And then we're going to come 400 feet up the driveway, 500 feet up the driveway. And you're going to have to dig that driveway up. And then we're going to put two giant vaults. They're transformers. First of all, I thought it was just one transformer. They put a transformer in. Here's this beautiful home with this giant, looks like someone built a 500-unit apartment house with a transformer in front. One house. And then a big box shows up again today. That's a pedestal. It goes next to the transformer. So here's another big thing going in. Big, giant, ugly thing ruining this house. And I saw that, and I just lost it. Now, I had this electrician with me. I know, I really like this guy. He's kind of goofy. I'm goofy, so the two of us get along real good. And he's not saved, I don't think. And he watches me. He knows who I am. And I went down, and he said, I said, well, these guys, they didn't tell us anything. They just popped this transformer in, and look at this. Look at this big monster in front of my house. This is ridiculous. And nobody wants to take responsibility. Nobody wants to do anything. No, I mean, a year and a half later, you think anybody's out there apologizing and trying to help us to get this done right? Oh, no, just do it and pay for it. Oh, man, I just wanted to... And I turned to him, who's watching me, and I said, I just want to cuss. And he says, well. And I looked at him and I said, but I'm not going to. Because he was watching me to see whether or not I would. So I went in my house quietly and cussed off. No, I didn't. And I've kept myself all day long righteous because I'd really like to smack somebody. I'd really like to cuss at somebody. I'd really like to call them some names. You know what I mean by names? What, you guys are so righteous, you forgot? You know exactly what I'm talking about. You do it every time you get in a freeway and someone cuts you off before you even get home from church. Don't tell me we're not in the same thing. I have to fight to hold on to righteousness because all the time, unrighteousness wants to rise up from my flesh and cause me to be something that God says I'm not. I'll close with this verse about that subject, and it's really a cool verse. Job writes these words. Anybody know who Job is? He had a bit of a problem, didn't he? Anybody ever had problems worse than Job? Let me know. We'll write a book and put it in there for you. Slide it right on in. We'll put it in the Rock Bible called John Hernandez. Job writes these words. It says, yet the righteous will hold to his way. And he who has clean hands will be stronger and stronger. Man, I'm telling you, you talk about health. The righteous will hold on to being righteous. Even though the flesh rises up and you really, come on, you really like to punch their lights out. But you don't. You really like to verbally say it like it is. You'd really like to, you know, let the flesh out, but you don't. Because he who has clean hands, stands in righteousness, watch this, will be healthier and healthier. Come on, the Lord give you a great big word tonight. Give him a hand clap. Will you do that? Just want to make sure everybody's all right with God before you go. You do not want to die and go to hell. You don't want to do that. Nobody wants to live out life on the earth, die, find yourself missing God, and going to hell. The only one way that you can get to heaven, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. There's only one way, and he tells us in John 3rd chapter how to get to heaven. He said these words, you must be born again. Now, when I say the words born again, most people in America go like, they turn off. Because Hollywood's tricked you to believe that born again people are idiots, fools, radicals, fanaticals. That's not what the Bible is describing. A born again person is somebody who has given God all of their heart and all of their life. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. Always has been, listen to me, always will be, all or nothing. I'll prove it to you. Are you listening? I'll prove it to you. Last book in the Bible, book of Revelation, you've heard of it. Jesus is speaking. He says, I'm coming again. When I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. Because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. What a crude, rude statement. I'll vomit you from my mouth. What he's really saying is people that call themselves Christians that are lukewarm are not real Christians at all. And they're going to get vomited from the mouth of Jesus. Listen, you cannot get to heaven being lukewarm. Lukewarm is somebody who thinks they're a Christian, but are not really Christians. They have head knowledge about who Jesus is. They know him. They know him in their head about being the Son of God, going to the cross. They know that in their head. But the devil knows him, and he's not going to heaven either. So you can't get to heaven by what you have in your head. It has to do with what you've done with your heart. It's a heart relationship with God. It's about giving God all of your heart and giving God all of your life. You can't just live righteously and you get to go to heaven. That won't work. You can't do it. You can't be good enough to get to heaven. You can't be nice enough to get to heaven. You can't be sweet enough to get to heaven. Your mom and dad can't tell you you're a Christian and that gets you to heaven. You must be born again. You're going to have to give God all of your heart. Hey. You're going to have to give God all of your life. It's what you got to do. Now, I'm going to tell you this right now. You got to give it to him because he won't steal it from you. It's your heart and your life. He's not a conniver to talk you out of it. He's not a manipulator to make you do this. He's not floating around in some cosmic cloud with a 2x4, hit you over the head and make you do it. He could do that. He could make you do it, but he doesn't. Here, notice he gives you a free will choice. I choose to give God all my heart. I choose to give God all my life. Be born again, headed for heaven, and denied my presence in hell. Now, wait a minute. Get this picture. God, who creates the heavens and the earth, could make a billion robots that look, act just exactly like you. And they all stand there and sing and worship God. Why didn't he do that? Because it's not about singing and worshiping God. It's about you making a free will choice. I choose to be a Christian. I choose to give God all my heart. I choose to give God all my life. And without that choice, nothing works. And today, in this safe, friendly place, we've had a good time. Some of you need to get right with God. You know how it said the righteous flourish like the palm tree? The only way you get righteous is when the blood of the Lord washes you clean from your sins. Then you're righteous before God because of Jesus. You can't act your way into it. The blood's got to wash you clean. That's what this is all about. And you've got to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior. It's as clear as that, as simple as that, and as fun as that. And yet it is everlasting life that you're going to, all by making a commitment tonight of all of your heart and all of your life. I've told you the truth. I told you how it is. I'm up front with you and in your face. Now, are you going to sit back and keep denying the things that you know you need to do? Or are you going to get right with God and give God all of your heart and give God all of your life? Here we are in this safe, friendly place. We've laughed, we've clapped, we've sung songs. Some people have cried, got touched by God. God spoke to them right before your eyes. Why would you want to not receive Jesus? It's a good thing, not a bad thing. But in order to do that, you're going to have to make a commitment of all of your heart and all of your life. Because that's what he's after in the Bible. Did you know from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, that's what the Bible is all about? Showing you how great God is and what kind of a commitment you need to make towards him. That's what this is all about, from the beginning to the end. And tonight, here you are in this safe, friendly place. You say, Pastor, how do I get right with God? Okay, well, let's get right with God his way, not your way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I will deny you. In a moment, I'll count to three. I'll go like this. One, two, three. Now, I'm going to pop my hands together. Then I'll go like this. Bang! When you hear that sound. Bang! After I say three, I'll go one, two, three. Bang! Your hand goes up. I'll see your hand go up. I'll see your hand and put it right back down. Because he said these words. Listen to what Jesus said. You do it his way, not your way, not my way, but his way. He said, if you confess me before men, I'm a man, I'll see it. He says, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, when you know you need to get your hand up and you don't, he says, I will deny you before my Father. So whether you get acknowledged by him or disknowledged or whatever the word is by him, you're going to tonight make the choice yourself. It's your call. It's your choice. Who should raise your hand in a moment when I pop my hands together? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, never given him all of your life, hey, I'm speaking to you. If you're one of those people who are in here and you're not sure, hey, make sure. Say, I'm not sure. I've always believed. I've always gone to church. I joined my last church. But I don't know if I've really ever given him my heart. Well, make sure. Make sure. What's wrong with that? Because I'll tell you what, it's too important to mess with. All across this auditorium tonight, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, back in the foyer by television, online, wherever you're at, God's watching you. You can get your hand up before God. And all of us that are in here right now, get ready to pop your hand up if you know you need to. This is your time. This is your day of salvation. Are you ready? Here it is. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Thank you. Back over here. There's 16. Thank you. God bless you. 17. Thank you. I think 18, 19, 20. Thank you. God bless you. There's 20. There's 21 somewhere back there. You're pointing back there somewhere. I don't know where they're at. 21. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else real quick? There's 20, 21 people. Is that you back there? Did you raise your hand? God bless you. Yeah, 21, 22. There's another one, 23. God bless you. Going for God. Going for God. Can I tell you something? Before I go any further, you'll stand alone before God. People you're next to, they probably won't be with you. They'll stand alone. So why would you want to wait for them to give you approval to do this? This is between you and God right now, and it's your time. There's 21. Anybody else need to do this? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Well, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 20 or 21 people. Ain't God good? All 20 or 21 of you, here's what I want you to do. I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend. Get your stuff. I want you to get out of your seat. I want you to get in the aisle. Meet me in front. Is that okay? Nobody leaves during this period of time because when you go that way, it discourages people from coming this way. So everybody, let's stand. Give them a hand. If you didn't raise your hand, but you should have, you can come too. Come on, it's not too late. Just come. Just come, 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 come.
And I serve.
Come on, if you raise your hand, come on. I appreciate the fact that you raised your hand. Don't get as far as raising your hand and then not responding to God. You don't get saved because you raise your hand. You will not find that in the Bible that says when Pastor Jim claps his hands together, you raise your hand and you get to come to heaven. We're going to pray with you, give you some free information. You're going to invite Jesus into your heart, and you need to do that. And if Jesus can walk a beaten, bloody path because they knocked the snot out of him, broke his back open, blood all over the place, spit all over him, the Son of God, creator of the heavens and earth, that did nothing for you, then you can walk a safe aisle for Jesus. Some of you in here need to get out of your seat, and you know it. You need to come right now and get your stuff and come. I won't embarrass you, but you need to come. Is that okay? I'm just encouraging you to do the right thing. This is the right thing. You come, and don't let anybody stop you from coming, especially the devil. Get out of your seat and come. Let's sing that one more time. Come on, come on, come on, come on.
And I surrender all. And I surrender all.
Come on, come on.
And unto thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender.
Oh, man, I hate to lose you. But praise God for you guys that came. Put a smile on your face. This is a good thing, not a bad thing. You're not going to the morgue, nor are you going to hell. This, you're going to go to heaven, and that's a good thing. And right now, in heaven, Debbie always does this. Your angels are in heaven, and they're partying. She always goes like this. And they're partying because the Bible says they rejoice when you get saved. So they've been waiting for you to do this. They'll have one question for you when you get to heaven. What took you so long? But I know. This is my friend over here waving at you. His name is Pastor Joel. He's going to pray with you, give you some free stuff. Only takes a few moments. Will you make a left turn and follow Pastor Joel right over there? Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.